Om Namah Shivaya. Hi friends, how are you? In this video, we are going to learn about corticospinal tract. Okay. First introduction. Traditionally, corticospinal tract, pyramidal tract, and upper motor neurons are used interchangeably. But strictly speaking, these are not all together synonyms. Okay. There are two groups of corticospinal tracts. First is lateral and the second is anterior corticospinal tracts. First lateral. Lateral corticospinal tract constitutes about 80% of the fibers in the corticospinal pathway. 80% of the fibers in the corticospinal pathway. This is the most important descending pathway for the control of skeletal voluntary muscle. Skeletal voluntary muscle activities is controlled by lateral corticospinal tract. Okay, next. Anterior or ventral corticospinal tract constitutes about 20% of the fibers in the corticospinal pathway. Involved in the control of posture. Posture is controlled by the anterior or ventral corticospinal tract. Next, coming to the origin. The fibers of corticospinal tract originate from primary motor cortex, we call area 4, especially from the large motor cells in the bells in the fifth layer of the precentral gyrus. The fibers of corticospinal tract originate from the primary motor cortex area 4, especially from the large motor cells of bells in the fifth layer of precentral gyrus. There are about 30,000 Bell cells in the cortex, whereas about 1 million axons are present in the corticospinal tract, which clearly indicate that corticospinal fibers also originate from other areas in the cortex. The other cortical motor areas include premotor cortex, that is lateral part of the area 6, supplementary motor area, medial part of the area 6, and primary somatosensory cortex. It is area 3, 1, 2 and the parietal cortex, area 5 and 7. Next, coming to the motor cortex and sensory cortex. Motor cortex constitutes about 60% of the fibers. And in this 60%, 30% from area 4 and 30% from area 6. And the sensory cortex constitutes about 40% of the fibers in the corticospinal tract. Next, coming to the cores. Fibers arising from different parts of the cortical areas converge through the posterior limb of the internal capsule. Next, as the fibers in the subcortical areas appear in a, radiating form, they are collectively known as corona radiator. See here, this is the cortex region. Okay guys, this is the cortex region, and below the cortex region, this is the subcortical region. Okay, here these are coming like radiating form, so we call this as corona radiator. And these fibers are converged at, see, all are converging here. All these fibers are converging at the internal capsule. See here, corona radiatum. As the fibers in the subcortical area appear in a radiating form, they collectively known as corona radiata. After passing through internal capsule, the fiber descend down in the ventral brain stem. As the cerebral peduncle, in the medulla, the fiber pass through the foramen. That is medullary foramen. See. This corona radiata enters the internal capsule and comes down and the in the ventral medulla okay in the vent and these fiber enter the medulla in foramen region After passing through the internal capsule, the fiber descend down in the ventral brainstem as the cerebral peduncles. In the medulla, the fiber pass through the foramen, which is medullary foramen. About 80% of the fiber pass through the foramen immediately decussate, crossing over the opposite side, and descend down in the lateral funiculars of the tract. This forms the lateral corticospinal tract. Eighty percent of the fibers coming through the this foramen in medulla. It is formed by about 80% of the fibers. After passing through the foramen, immediately decussate, cross over the opposite side, and descend down in the lateral funiculars of the spinal cord. This forms the lateral corticospinal tract. The lateral corticospinal fibers have monosynaptic connection with the anterior horn cells. The remaining 20% of the fiber descend down in ipsilateral and don't decussate in the anterior funiculus of the spinal cord. This constitutes the ventral R. Anterior corticospinal tract. These fibers cross over to the opposite side. Only other spinal cord segments through their termination on their interneurons. And this 20% of the fibers constitutes the anterior corticospinal tract. Okay, guys. Next, coming to the termination. The fibers of lateral corticospinal tract terminate on the lateral group of motor neurons in the ventral horn of the spinal cord. These lateral corticospinal cord terminate in the ventral horn or spinal cord. This lateral corticospinal tract terminate in the ventral horn or spinal cord. About 30% of lateral corticospinal cord spinal tract fibers terminate directly on motor neuron and 70% fibers terminate through the interneurons. These motor neurons innervate the distal limb muscles. see these motor neurons. These are the motor neurons. These innervate the distal group of muscle. This indicates the distal group of muscle. These motor neurons innervate the distal group of muscle. The fibers of ventral corticospinal tract don't directly terminate on the motor neurons. Rather, they end on interneurons in the same side of the spinal cord, which in turn cross over the opposite side and terminate on the medial group of motor neurons. Few fibers from interneurons terminate on the same side of medial group of motor neurons. The motor neurons supply the proximal limb and axial supply the proximal limb muscles and axial muscles of the body. Next, coming to the functions. The motor cortex is mainly involved in initiation, planning and control of the movement. The corticospinal tract transmits central command signal from motor cortex to the spinal cord, interneurons and motor neurons. The lateral corticospinal tract controls the skilled voluntary movements of the body. Anterior corticospinal tract control posture. See, in this figure, this is the lateral corticospinal tract and this is the anterior corticospinal tract, okay? And this lateral corticospinal tract controls the skilled movements and this anterior corticospinal tract controls the postural movements, okay? It controls the posture. Okay, next, coming to the effects of lesion. The lesion of lateral corticospinal tract results in impairment of skilled voluntary activities like writing, painting, etc. But as in rubrospinal tract is intact, the subject recovers after few days or weeks. Lesion of lateral corticospinal tract results in impairment of skilled voluntary activities like writing and painting. But as the rubrospinal tract is intact, the subject recovers after few days or weeks. However, isolated lesion of the lateral corticospinal tract is very common in humans. In addition, the diseases that affect corticospinal tract also affect the corticobulbar tracts that influences activities of extrapyramidal systems. Thus, a pure corticospinal tract disease is not seen in humans. Pure corticospinal tract disease is not seen in humans. Lesion of anterior corticospinal tract in animals result in inability to maintain posture while walking, climbing, but in humans a postural deficit follows the lesion of anterior corticospinal tract is not prominent because two reasons. Firstly, this tract is not well developed in humans. Secondly, other major posture regulating pathways, especially the reticulospinal tract and vestibulospinal tracts, are still intact. Next, coming to the clinical importance. The corticospinal pathway may be interrupted anywhere along its course from the cortex to spinal cord. However, the lesion of corticospinal tract at the internal capsule or capsular lesion is the commonest pyramidal tract lesion. As the fibers coming from different parts of the cortex pass through a narrow tunnel in the posterior limb of the internal capsule, disease of the internal capsule results in come incomplete interruption of corticospinal fibers. This leads to contralateral hemiplegia. It should be noted that ascending fiber system from basal ganglia and cerebellum pass close to the internal capsule. Therefore, extrapyramidal system are also affected in addition to involvement of corticospinal fibers. Consequently, pyramidal tract disease due to capsular lesion is often termed as complete upper motor neuron paralysis. Consequently, pyramidal tract disease due to capsular lesion is often termed as complete upper motor neuron paralysis. The usual cause of capsular lesion is the rupture of Charcot's artery, lenticulostriate branch of middle cerebral artery. This is also called as artery of cerebral hemorrhage, as it accounts for more than 60% of the causes of intracerebellar hemorrhage. Okay guys, we completed the corticospinal tract. If you like this video, like, share and subscribe. Thank you. Next video about upper motor neuron paralysis. Okay guys, if you like this video, like, share and subscribe. Thank you.